Hello. In this video, we're going to take a look at the basic block for the differential amplifier, which is the differential pair. And we're going to do it using BJT transistors. So the differential pair the BJT differential pair consists of two transistors. Which are connected at their emitter terminals. The differential input is applied across the base of the two transistors. So you have V in 1, V in 2. Differential signal will be the delta between those two. Obviously, you do need to bias those transistors with some, let's imagine a current source in the imaginary case. And then the output is taken at the collector of the transistors. So if this is Q1 and this is Q2, this will be the collector voltage of transistor Q1, which we will refer to as Vout1. Vout2 will be the collector voltage of Q2. And then keep in mind our differential input signal is equal to V in 1 minus V in 2. Our output signal is equal to Vout1 minus Vout2. It's a balanced output type of amplifier in this case. And notice that I have included two resistors at the collector. I'll refer to them as RC1 and RC2. Let's imagine that they are equal to each other, so I'm just going to refer to them more generally as RC to simplify things. And normally that will be the case. I mean, this is a circuit that's going to rely heavily on symmetry, and so we're going to want, for the most part, things to be the same or matching on both sides of the circuit. And later on, we're going to see other configurations where RC can be substituted with an active load, but for now, let's just keep it simple in order to visualize it. Before we start doing more thorough or more robust analysis, let's say, to come up with expressions for differential gain, common mode gain, CMRR, etc., I do want to take a moment to first look at qualitatively what's going on in the circuit so that we gain an intuitive understanding. And then when it gets to the part of doing the mathematical calculations, things make a little bit more sense as opposed to just being numbers and formulas coming out of nowhere. So we're going to look at three cases, behavior of the circuit under three particular conditions. First condition is under a common mode signal. So let's imagine that V in 1 is equal to V in 2. All of the signal is common mode signal. What will be the behavior of the circuit in that particular case? And then we're going to look at two different possible scenarios for a differential signal. The first one is when we have a large differential signal, and we'll see what we mean by large and how large it has to be. And then we're going to look at a small differential signal. Needless to say, we're looking at a small signal type of amplifiers, and so we're going to be most interested in what happens when we have a small differential signal and the behavior of the circuit under that scenario. But we're going to take a look at all the cases, and like I said, initially just qualitatively, just to gain an understanding. So case number one, let's imagine that all of our signal is common mode signal. So behavior of the amplifier under a pure common mode input signal, which basically means that the input signal V in 1 is equal to V in 2. And so I'm going to refer to it as simply VICM, common mode. And if that is the case, if those two input signals are equal to each other, we can see that the emitter voltages are going to be equal to each other because they're tied together. And so just by mere design, we know that VE1 is going to be equal to VE2, or emitter voltage for transistor Q1 equals emitter voltage for transistor Q2, and they're both going to be sitting 0.7 volts lower than the common mode input signal if we assume these transistors are operating in the linear region, which is something that we want when we're dealing with amplifiers. So this is going to be equal to PICM minus 0.7 volts to turn on the transistors. So Q1, Q2 will be inactive linear region. Because of the symmetry of the circuit, we can see that if we have the same base voltage and the same emitter voltage, the base emitter voltage is going to produce a certain collector current. Collector current is going to be equal, approximately equal to IS times E to the VVE divided by VT, the thermal voltage. Therefore, if we look at the transistor as a transconductance device, where there is an output current in response to an input voltage, that input voltage is going to be VVE. And so since the VVEs are equal, because of the symmetry of the circuit, we are going to have that the collector currents are also going to be equal. And notice I'm writing lowercase voltage and current parameters, but uppercase subscripts. And the reason for that is I'm not talking right now about a small signal AC, but I'm talking about the overall voltage. In this case, you know, it's a common mode signal. We could assume a common mode DC signal, but not necessarily. And so this really represents everything, DC plus AC portion of the signal. Lowercase letter, uppercase subscript. So IC1 equals IC2. And since the overall current flowing through both of the branches is equal to I, the current that we have set through the tail branch over there, we must assume that that current gets divided equally between the two branches. And so the current through each one of those branches is going to be equal to I halves. Okay, so far so good. And in that case, if we have I halves flowing through that branch, and I have flowing through that branch, because we have our collector resistor RC, the voltage in each one of those collector terminals is going to be equal to VCC minus the voltage drop across the RC resistor. And so we have that VC1, which is also equal to VC2, is going to be equal to VCC minus I halves divided by RC. In the case of I, notice that I am using an uppercase letter, and the reason for that is that this is the this is a biasing current source, so this is a DC current source. Okay, and those will be my collector voltages in this case. And so we can see under a common mode signal, a lot of symmetry. Differential input signal is equal to zero. Current divides equally between the two branches, collector voltages are equal to each other, and therefore the differential output voltage is simply equal to zero. So, and I've labeled those as, you know, VC1 and VC2, which correspond to VL1 and VL2 as labeled in my circuit. And so I can say that VOUT1 minus VOUT2 is simply equal to zero. And therefore, the gain, which is equal to or proportional to the difference in output voltage, is going to be equal to zero. And so in this case, the gain in response to a common mode signal is equal to zero. We refer to that as the common mode gain. It will just be the gain in response to a common mode signal. So that's case one, fairly simple. Let's take a look at case two. What happens to the circuit, or what's the behavior when I apply a large differential signal? So I'm now increasing either VIN1 or VIN2 with respect to the other one. Let's imagine that I increase VIN1 for the sake of example with respect to VIN2 by a large amount. Then I will have a large differential signal. And as we will see in one or two videos, what we are going to consider large is large enough to basically shift all the current one direction or the other. And that's going to be approximately a differential signal that's greater than half of the thermal voltage. For now, let's just imagine we are talking in the volt range, so plus minus 1 volt. In reality, anything that's larger than, say, 10, 15 millivolts, it's going to be considered a large signal, and it's going to drive the circuit into a large differential signal operation. So let's see what happens in this case. I'm going to go ahead and separate my cases. So when I have a large differential signal, there are two possibilities. Either Vin1 becomes greater than Vin2 by 1 volt, or Vin2 becomes greater than Vin1 by 1 volt. It could be either way. So let's imagine, let's look first at the first case, case A, where Vin1 is equal to 1 volt, let's say, and Vin2 is equal to 0. And in that case, well, you can already see in this particular circuit that wouldn't work. That will just cut off my transistors, because my Vin2 is sitting at 0 volts and my current source down here is grounded, so I don't have enough headroom to even turn on the transistor. So to simplify things, I'm going to go ahead and, since I don't want to now have to add some sort of DC offset to my input signals, which will cloud a little bit the explanation, I'm just going to go ahead and just say, okay, so this is going from plus VCC, positive source, to negative VEE, some negative source, negative supply. And so in that case, my analysis in the first case doesn't change a bit, and in this case I just keep it simpler, because I can keep my Vin2 sitting at 0 volts. I don't need to add a DC offset to both Vin1 and Vin2. So in that case, once one of the base voltages has increased by a lot with respect to the other one, we can see our emitters are still tied together. So now basically what I have is a larger base emitter voltage on one side than the other, so a larger collector current. And we can see that if we have a large enough differential signal, certainly 1 volt will be large enough, all of the current is going to be steered on the one side of the circuit. So basically, all of the current is going to flow through Q1. Therefore, our collector current for transistor 1 will be equal to the overall tail current, and our collector current for transistor 2 will just be equal to 0. Transistor 2 will be in cutoff. The emitter voltages are going to be equal to each other. VE1 will be equal to VE2 because they are connected together physically. And if VE1 is sitting at 1 volt, then the emitter voltage is going to be sitting 0.7 volts below that, or at 0.3 volts. So 1 minus 0.7 equals 0.3 volts, which means Q1 will be in the active region, but Q2 will be in cutoff, because since Vn2 is sitting at 0 volts, if the emitter voltage is sitting at 0.3 volts, then there's not the voltage there to forward bias the base emitter junction. It is reverse biased, therefore Q2 is in cutoff, which is consistent with all the current flowing through the one side of the circuit. In that case, we will have a collector voltage on the collector of transistor 1, VC1, which is equal to VCC minus the current flowing through the collector of C1, which is the overall current I in this case, times RC, whereas VC2, since we have no current flowing through that circuit, no voltage drop across resistor RC, it's just going to be sitting at VCC. Okay, and we could have performed the same analysis with the opposite polarities, meaning with Vn1 sitting at 0 volts and Vn2 sitting at 1 volt. In that case, all the currents will be steered through Q2. So IC1 is going to be equal to 0, and IC2 will be equal to the overall tail current I. V1 will still be equal to VE2, and it will still be 1 minus 0.7, which is 0.3 volts, which will mean Q1 will be cut off, and Q2 will be in the active region. And therefore, VC1 will be VCC, since there is no current flow through that branch, no voltage drop across that resistor RC, whereas VC2 will be equal to VCC minus I times RC. And again, this was the case for large differential signal. Not going to be very useful for amplification in this mode of operation. It is useful for other applications. For example, there is a family of digital circuits known as ECL or emitter coupled logic that basically use the differential pair as their building block. And what you're trying to do is precisely this, is steer all the current in one way, one branch or the other. But for analog amplifiers, we are going to want the opposite case. If we've taken it to the point where all the current has been steered in one direction, then we've taken it too far. We are going to be restricting ourselves to signals that don't quite get to steer the current all in one direction or the other, but create a small difference or a small imbalance in the current flowing through one branch and the other. And that's going to be our case number 3 here.